I am black as the night, from which the light of a new day descends. I am past, present, and future. I'm the anointed of heaven. I am what I am. I'm the blended colors of life that light the bridge into the new age. I'm seed, plant, and flower. I'm the anointed of earth. I am that I am. These words called forth the intention of being a self-created, self-conscious, self-willed being. The power that is within us is for the future. Future selves of us. I greet you, brothers and sisters, with the word Sawubona, which given from the Zulu language means we see you. The understanding that is in this seeing that we witness who we are to become for each other in order to coexist in a world of shared meaning and shared understanding. The mystery tells us that we exist in a cosmos entirely of our own. The human being is a being of cosmic dimensions, meaning that we have to reduce ourselves to be in a world of existence. We have to extinguish a certain kind of memory to be even in our body. And so this meditation tells us we stand in two worlds at the same time. It stands in the world of cosmos and in the worlds of matter in order to exercise the transference of light, life and love from this dimension of eternality to causality and temporality. We're here temporarily to assume the consciousness to agree on how to move immortality to a space that dies. And to come to terms with this task of being in service of immortality. Being conscious of the initiation towards being sons and daughters of light. To find meaning in this, one has to do certain inner work. Inner meaning not inside the body, but inside the substance itself that makes the body possible, even that far. To extinguish the concept of existence in order to find the non-existent part of ourselves that knows how to put back together the world in order, in the right order and lawfulness of its own perfection. We've inherited an imperfected world. By necessity, existence has within it a kind of corruption, an unconsciousness that does not allow us to be in a shared reality unless we perfect ma'at in our own consciousness. There is an assumption that we all share as we sit here together, the assumption that we are in the same world. And a whole lot of people exist in so many conflicts every day because of this assumption. Why should not things be more perfect if we share the same world? The idea is that we don't share the same world because you are cosmic beings. You share cosmos, unrealized, unfulfilled, unactualized potential. And unless that potential reaches a certain degree of consciousness, we don't share anything but future potential. Yet so much of our existence is in conflict of this assumption that we should have inherited something more perfect, more formed, and more defined. Well, if we take this idea of this meditation, I am black as the night, meaning that if we actually go into this inner space where there is no light, no defined form, no defined concept, no defined identity, and to self-realize there, the speech that we will find in that inner contemplation of selfhood is not the speech that we use now to try to convince and persuade each other that I am right. But a speech that invites a kind of truth that gives to the other everything that you potentially cognize as yourself. And this is what Creator did. Give to the other its power to become self-conscious as itself. It's a speech that says, you become yourself, and when you do, you will know who I am. So there is no God until you become yourself. Why? Because there is no existence of a God until you become a self-realized existence of God. This is the power of self-becoming. God doesn't want to be a God for God's self. The idea of divinity is that it gives its substance to its offspring. Out of pure love, it gives away everything as its potential and says, do what you can with it. And when you fulfill that out of your love for yourself, then God exists. The idea of immaculate conception is not generated by existed beings. There is a substance in us that is not born of matter, that is not conceived in thought, that is not willed by self-interest, but out of a love for its future. It surrenders its potential to this corrupted substance of existence that limits its potential because of a feeling that I should have something better. I should have gotten more from my mother and father. And here is a divine mother, father saying, I've given you everything. Even that which I have not even yet conceived as myself, in order that you may trust that which you hold as your birthright, to find a way to become meaningfully self-conscious. And so I want to bring this impulse to you today to ask, what have you done with your inheritance? this is the thing. We don't know how much we've had. This is the challenge, is that we don't know how much we have. And there's no accounting process for that. There's not enough history to measure how much we have. And so, because we've not been given a kind of measurement other than the experiences that we have gained so far, we can only turn to the soul, because only the soul knows truly what has happened in our lives from the time of this generative birth out of cosmos into existence, to then find out what to do with the meaning of that substance. And so the ancients who had gone into this inner sanctuary of consciousness, this holy of holies, this soul power, to define what it is to become self-aware and engaged of will, to make the self-becoming a realized practice of a priesthood, to define how to build a temple of man, of humanity. This sacred craft of temple building. To say, what parts of the temple do we build first in order to become fundamentally free of this egotistical kind of self-defeat of expecting something from someone else when we have everything within ourselves? The challenge about this level of inheritance, because it's so proportionally distributed equally among every human being, there comes up a form of energy we call envy. And we look at each other and see how each other uses this substance and become envious of the act of will. Why did you use yours that way and I couldn't? Equality is not a social construct. It's not a political, a kind of affair, you know? Equality, you know, the things that we walk and march for. Well, I'll come back to that in a moment. Because what was gained there had nothing to do with the courts and American law. I'll come back to that in a moment. But let me first say this about equality. It is not engendered as a social construct. If you're to become equal to anything, we have to stand above the social realm and be equal to the laws that makes human being exist. Equal to the forces that make existence possible. Not equal to social status and political status. Yeah? There is a kind of memory in us that wants to be equal to the cosmic reality and cosmic memory that we carry in our souls. To stand in the divine birthright of self-becoming by the transformation of the ego from being grounded in the self-feeling that I don't have something because it appears so, and to find this potentialless utterance of pata, self-created speech, If you want something, say, let it be so. Test your power of speech and you will be surprised of how much you will change in your own life and in the life of the world. Test your speech. These virtues are not exercises for the intellect. This is not an intellectual school. When these virtues were articulated, there was no intellect. When I'm saying, there was not that stage of consciousness yet in the world. There was a state of obedience in the world. There was a state of knowing I am that I am. That is when these virtues were created. We have to imagine a different kind of thinking in the ancient consciousness. The mind frames and the cognitive frameworks of thinking that we now utilize were not the same in the articulated consciousness of the ancient peoples of the world. Their wisdom was transferred directly from the soul to their minds. They born into memory of things far more truthful to themselves as we are now. This corruption continues to happen in the mechanisms of the generations of life that puts us in odds with the divinity in ourselves for a particular purpose as well. But how does this ancient conceptualization happen? Is that we did not have a conflict with each other. Why? Because we remembered each other. Before birth, we remember who we were, and when we are born, we remember who we are. And so it was easy to go back into initiation of that self-becoming. But you ask anyone now if they want to be initiated, and they say, into what? Well, the thing is, the truth is, you can only be initiated into yourself. Because that's what initiation meant. Regeneration of self. Remembering of self. It wasn't to join something. It was to remember something. And you could only have remembered who you are and what you had experienced. Nothing beyond that. Or outside of that. And so I think about these virtues as we read them today. And particularly the control of action. What is that act of will that we must be in control of? Often we now situated in the ego, where we pursue certain things and we have to have these check and balances within ourselves whether or not we are doing the right thing. Well, it's not so much about right or wrong at this point, it's whether you are doing what you should be doing with your inheritance. Right and wrong puts us on a waiting kind of schedule for some kind of knowledge or more time, of which we will get neither, in order to do the right thing. Well, conscience in a moment tells you what the right thing is. Often we know what the right thing is. Now, because it often requires doing it for someone else, the right thing is always for someone else. You don't need anything for yourself. We don't need anything for ourselves. Our self is a giver of the right thing for someone else. That is the pattern of our creation. We were given everything in order to give everything in order to give everything. This is the right action towards creation. Your perfect gift is to be given away. The temple was not a storehouse. The temple was a place for the distribution of the wisdom of self. As it was a place to be initiated in the work of becoming self-conscious. And when you find your work, you go out and you do it. Now this measure of the ancient calendar that says, you know, you spend 40 years in the inner sanctum of self-development for the purpose of being able to develop the priesthood consciousness of moving through from the initiate phase of the entered apprentice into the mastery of this craft of being able to be a self-directed creative being. And they said you spent 40 years in this school, in the mystery schools. Well, 40 years then is a different kind of 40 than it is now as well. Because the calendar of the soul moves through the planets in a different way for different beings. And if you say in 40 years a person can come into cosmic consciousness, and we look at our own timeline of life and say, well, I'm over 40. Something should have happened by now. Well, the hopeful thing, it has happened. In the true sense, at 28 years old, you've gotten it. When Saturn comes back into the orbit of one's life at the place where you were born, it says to you, have you reconciled the conflict with your parents? Now, the thing is that we project it on our biological parents. We project the conflict on them, and we say that they didn't give us everything that we needed to be in this world, but that's not the parent that Saturn asks you about. Saturn asks our souls, have you reconciled who your parents really are? Because those two people that brought you into the physical world, you chose them. But your parent chose you. Your true parent, your divine parent, chose you. And in a certain way, they are you, hidden in this vessel of beingness, waiting for the right initiation, the right dialogue, to put them back into this co-creative task of crafting your existence. Now the thing is that when we think because we're 28, we're grown. You hear teenagers say, I'm grown. Well, this is the challenge. Into what? This is where the Immaculate Conception work now really starts, at 28 years old. Can I put my parents back to work on creating me? Now, let me say it again. Can I put them into the task of making me who I must become? Because now you have your parents in you. The act of will is to consider yourself as parent of yourself. Mother and father, masculine and feminine principles of creation, and put them to work in the art of self-becoming. There is a psychic kind of event happens in the life of a human being from between 21 and 28, in which we look out into the world and we begin to look at all the qualities of human beings that we will meet. And this is where the virtues makes most sense to us. Are any of these beings holding the virtue that allows me to reconcile my self-directed purpose in life? And from that 21 to 28 years old, we, through our social contact with the world, we decide whether we want to be in the work for ourselves, the true self, or not. Because it's there that we decide whether we will give away this power or how to hold it in such a way that allows us to stay true to the initiation that we will have to meet at 28 years old. Now, this is in the psyche, and the biology sometimes get in the way of that because it doesn't always follow that. If your soul experience is such that you've been prepared more to meet it sooner, you will meet it sooner. And some later, but this planetary master, and this sense of have confidence in the power of a master as teacher. And don't get it wrong; there are some good human beings as master teachers, but they're not the masters of our destiny. The planets are. The stars are your master teachers. There's no human being that will protect you from their task upon your soul, because they bypass the mind and they bypass the ego and they go right directly to the substance of your will. And if you're not willing to do what they ask of you, there's only one other choice: do or die. Initiation only has two portals, life or death. If you go forward, you live. Initiation is not to be miscommunicated as some social event. This has to do with our immortality. This has to do about being able to stand as a human being in the substance of life. And when we do not act in the pursuit of life, everything else dies, including our bodies, including our will for the aspiration of meaningful relationships in the world. And so we're not to take the mysteries as a kind of university, that we go there and we sit in class. This was a different kind of university. This was a kind of ritual space where the resistance to the laws of Ma'at, the laws of cosmos, the laws of creation, were allowed to enter directly into the streaming consciousness of human beings. And we stayed there crucified under its transformational power. And let me say, this crucifixion is not a Roman thing. It means to become resurrected, not to be persecuted. Crucifixion was not a persecution process. It was a restorative power in which you lay entombed in this body and resurrected by bringing back these creative virtues. So when religion took over consciousness and the intellect begins to interpret sacred science by creating philosophies, we then end up in a more conflict with the very nature of our beingness. And so in the goodness of our creation, there's a moment of every day when we are free of all of that stuff. As a light being, we have a moment of light every day, once a day, that could liberate a human being from this prison of self-defeat. This preparedness, and there's so many aspects of our opening ritual space today that have elements of this amazing legacy of how do we prepare for initiation and the act of self-becoming when that moment arises. The preparedness has to do with being able to accept the self from a standpoint of its capacity to nurture its creator. Let me say this. You can nurture the being that will give you everything in awareness of what is required for you to be able to reconcile this challenge of our everyday consciousness. This is a reverse aspect of the will. We nurture the parent in this sense, the parent in us. And there's only one thing that's required, one thing they ask. The obedience, again. And in this sense, obedience is not just like following rules, but following the motive of love that we find, trying to bring into our lives devotion to something that is true. And we resist this love force because everything else in the world tells us we should be hating something or should be disappointed by something, someone. And the habit of our psychology to predict patterns based on past experiences and do not prepare for communion with this Holy Spirit of ourselves that wants to unite us with our parents again. It's a great homecoming. This time spirit has to visit us every day or we will die. And it unites us with the willingness to stay connected to this creative power that continues to pour it poured substance into our lives for existence to be existence. But more than that, we're not to just to exist. We're also to experience the initiative of will to participate in the co-creation of this destiny, that if we stay within the lawfulness of this Trinity, these two parents and yourself, one will experience the guiding force of destiny towards the aims of your authentic life. It happens on a plane above the mind, in the psychic plane, where there's a certain kind of impulse trying to remind us not to resist this love force. And it's not a sentimental love either. It's not a love for something. Because in that space, there are no things. There are just beings. We live more in the world of being than in the world of things. In the everyday world, we kind of have a conceptual framework of the world as a world made up of things. But that's not the true nature of human consciousness. We are more aware, like 70% of our worldview has to do with relationships of people. And all of our decisions has to do with how we make judgments about them. And all most of our mental and emotional energy are tied up in these people's perception of each other. And then there is this reminder, moment by moment by moment, how to return to this sanctuary of our inner space and commune with the divine parent. Now, what does a parent look like in the social world? Because there is a kind of quality. Parts of our divine parent in ourselves are in each other. And this task from 21 to 28 is the period of asar, of trying to put back together these 14 pieces of self. We find the virtues that we need in other people. It's hard to conceptualize these virtues by ourselves, for ourselves. They're exemplified in other people. And we create relationships with them in order to transact the kind of emotional bonding to make sure that we create a community of virtue in order to stay in virtue. There will be no need for virtue if we were by ourselves. We need the virtues because we are in relationship with other people, and we practice them because of other people. But more so, we model them because of other people. And so communities are formed by people looking for an exact blueprint of their parents, where they can get the permission to do everything that they must do for that community, in service of that community, and be acknowledged and strengthened and supported by that community in their initiation as they continue forward. And this is the key to civility, to forming the agreements beyond what people can imagine they need and want for their self. There are things that would not be even conscious unless you are in the right relationship with another human being. We would not even know we need certain things unless, you know, the children come into your lives, right? And you realize, I should do better. Or you fall in love and you realize, well, I could do better with my life. I could make more happen. This is the human being. Self-interest is not a reality. It's an illusion. It's a psychological illusion generated by this materialistic form of reality that we have become so attached to. That I think I should get more because I'm not certain about the future. Well, let me tell you something. Your future is an immortal future. If you think this is it, I'll tell you it's not. There's more to come. More lifetimes to come. More relationships to experience in the expansion of the soul's power to determine its morality for immortal self-development. And if we think we have the enemies now that challenge us, just give yourself more time. I would think, do the work now, get out of it. Get out of this feeling that we need an enemy to be ourselves. We do not. Or this is the thing about divinity. They will send you the kind of enemy that will make you truly challenged. Why? Because you create your reality. We call it initiation. You create your initiation. And when we rationalize it that it's not hard enough, then we give ourselves permission to make it harder. So I invite us today to really think about this world becoming, the world not so much of matter, the world of a right relationship to each other as carriers of this occult virtue, meaning that it's hidden. The virtue to be able to create an agreement that we have what we need to be ourselves, and we have the right measure of substances to articulate the direction of what our lives should take in order to release those qualities into the world. There is no more time other than the moment of self-realization that makes expressive the life forces. If we do not have life, we do not have more time. And no one can give us more life. Only you can determine what moves from temporality to immortality. It's a thought that does that. If we do not create that thought, there is no meaning for the life that has to come out of this. Energy follows thought. Creation manifests what we think. Because the creators, this is the thing, they love us that they do not doubt us even if we are wrong. The creators do not doubt us even when we are wrong. They create our wrongness for us. They create our violence for us. They do not stand in the way of human beings. They do not keep us from doing good or harm because it is their will that they have committed to us. They will do as we say. Now the complication is, do not misuse divinity. Reciprocity is a law. What you do, you will inherit. It becomes the substance of your next life. Whatever path you have chosen, and I like the song says, you can make this heaven or hell. It is our doing. So I ask that each of us, as we say to each other, that we see each other in Sawubona. Let us commit to this seeing as not a seeing for looking at faults and wrong, but a seeing for the divinity that will allow us to perfect creating communities of destiny, whereby the willingness to be oneself for each other will become more enlivened and more expressive, and that once again, miracles can happen in the life of human beings. So I wish to you a very, very good miracle worker experience. Thank you so very much.
I'm going to ask you three questions, okay?
All right. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank
you. Three questions. Questions?
Thank you, Bishop, Mr. Bishop, for a very, very powerful message. Can you articulate for us what the fuel is that drives all of this?
there's one quality of free force that remains available to every human being, and that is attentiveness, attention, observation. Within the natural processes of the human life, and we live within different processes, chemical, biological, you know, psychical, mental, but there's one free force we call attention. Nothing takes it away, and nothing can take it away, because it's sourced by freedom. And so when we give our attention, we begin to move energy from this inner resource towards the world. Everything that we look at, that's why we use this word sauvona, anyone or anything that we look at becomes changed by our attention to it. And so a certain way, if we give attention to our circumstances, they may look bad initially or challenge initially, but your observation begins to order it and order your mental awareness of it, enter order your emotional connection to it, and eventually order an answer to it. So the process that remains available above and beyond this everyday world is this power that every one human being can begin with. Give at least one moment of attention to freedom.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you so much. You are so enlightening to me. As you must know, our wonderful queen Nzinga made her transition.
Yes.
And tomorrow is the funeral and celebration of her life. Mm. And I asked the question, how do we, as her friends, those who loved her dearly, help to assist as she moves into this realm of invisibility to us? Mm.
I remember her so dearly. ASCAP and this leadership of taking charge of reclaiming this stolen legacy, to be able to articulate a part of intellectual discourse around Africa's contribution to world civilization, to be able to look at a generation ahead of herself and take responsibility for their education. Yeah. We sing for them. Omaye, 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 Maya, Omaye, 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 Maya. Omaye, 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 Maya, Omaye, 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 Maya. Let's do two more. Omaye, 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 Maya, Omaye, Yemaya.
Greetings, Brother Bishop, the pastor, and Bird and his wife in their presence. Hi, my aunt family. My question to you is, can you explain to me the difference between having a premonition and the consciousness that you're so dynamically explaining to us today? I think I got the answer. I think he answered me, but if you can expound upon that just a little bit. I've often got confused about that, but today I think I'm clear on it. Thank you.
As human beings, we are prophetic. We see things that are to come before they come. Why? Because we create them to come. So in a certain way, those who have insight to certain qualities of events are to host them with the right consciousness, because they will come. And they can come if we trust that we want to be the host for them to come into the world. There is a capacity in us to be able to participate in the sphere of life where realities are created before they manifest. And so we call them psychic capacities. And it's different than mental capacities. Mental means, in a certain way, the construct of putting together a plan for what may happen. But the psyche prepares for what will happen, because it's a co-creator in that reality. And so a premonition, it's almost like a prophetic vision into something that one has to be able to determine who plays a part in this phenomenon. Because not all images that comes to consciousness will be realized. But you have to figure out, just like a dream can tell you certain things, a premonition tells you other things. And in the awake consciousness, this is a discourse between you and some other people. A premonition is not your own creation. It is a psychic link to other people who are thinking simultaneously about this probability for something that wants to enter the world. So it's different than a dream. And so what we can do is to observe the pattern of what the premonition is about, because it also gives you sometimes a location, and it gives you a sense of who else are part of that. And it might be good to follow through on calling someone if you get an impression that someone else is in it, and talk it through. Because we don't receive premonition of something by ourselves. Someone, if you examine it, someone else says, well, I had the same thought. And it's often with people who have a connection to your destiny. So thank you so very much. Have a great rest of the day.
One more in the back. Thank you.
Yes.
Last question.
I have a question about 2012 and Neptune orbiting, and also about Saturn and no Pluto with Capricorn and Uranus with Aries in the square of next year. The first square will come June 24th, 2012, and Neptune will finally fully orbit next year in June.
I'm not an astrologer, so I can't go into full depth of this, of these alignments of those planets, but I'll say something more specifically to you. because you express Pluto. Pluto has to do with a generation. It's as a planet that reminds us that we have a collective capacity in the world, as well as an individual capacity in the world. And this 2012 is a generational kind of initiation around the right use of information, or the transference of information and knowledge into a social significant task. And so the social significance of what's arising next year has to do not with these climatic forms of apocalypse that people are talking about at the ends of things. This is more a certain way taking account for what you give your power to. Now, this is a thing that next year the power grid will change in three forms: environment, economy, and social systems. So what will take over next year, more so than the political system, is the social system. I'm going to not say, you know, the Facebook phenomena, but something more profound than that. When the generation takes over their social power and no longer give it away because time has not demanded you to be in your initiation. And so this 2012 is a transference of the grid of consciousness from being unconscious to conscious. And so people will actually be taking back their powers. And that is what Pluto gives us next year. And what we'll say about the economy, that in what makes money is because you give your consent to it. It's an agreement, and if without that agreement, there is no money. And so you have to ask, what new currencies are coming into the world next year? What new forms of currencies that will come in? And then this grid that has to do with the environment. The sensitivity forces that has been obstructing nature from being able to change according to nature's own processes will begin to reflect back on us. So in us, our sensitivity forces, like our self-interest, our fundamentalism, is robbing nature of its energy. And there's a certain detriment in it is that the people who need to fall asleep will fall asleep, and the people who need to wake up will wake up, and the world will change as according to that.
Give it up. Give it up, Brad. Give it up, Brad. Give it up, Brad. Give it up. Give it up. Give it up.
Thank you for your question.
I just want to ask you, friends, family, congregation, neighbors, loved ones, if you truly, truly, truly enjoyed the message today, after service, let Brother Bishop know. During the week, next week, let Pastor Mary Cara know. See, he didn't desert us. Actually, he gave us a treat. He went on a retreat and gave us a treat all at the same time. So if you're watching this morning, Reverend Mary Cara, we want to thank you tremendously for this blessing that you bestowed upon us this morning.
Give it up, KRST family. One more time. Thank you, brother. Thank you. I'm Brother Myro Haru Karara, and I have an opportunity to now look out at the family and ask us to take blessing and take appreciation in hosting Brother Bishop and hosting ourselves so that we now can express through our energy, through our money, our appreciation for this institution, practicing the law of giving and receiving, practicing the principle of reciprocity. So we ask again that you understand that we are divine creators and we are abundant, and that this institution deserves your appreciation and your energy so that we can bring this and grow this and share this beautiful, beautiful institution with more and more and more as we get better and better and better. Ashe?
Ashe.
Greetings, family. I'm Sherry Randolph, and I'll be bringing your announcements for today. If you have a bulletin, please look in your bulletin.